Hi everyone! Today we're going to talk about a very important topic, the performance of your game. Specifically, the performance of your mesh assets. These meshes are constantly becoming more complex, which translates to more vertices, indices, and triangles. This means that more GPU resources are required to process them. Therefore, in some games it may be critical to store these meshes in the most efficient way. The tool that we will use in this video is called Mesh Optimizer, and it was created by Arseny Kopolkin. Arseny has his own YouTube channel with various videos on Vulkan as well as other topics. See the link in the video description below. Mesh Optimizer is an open source library that should be fairly simple to integrate into most 3D pipelines. It is capable of dropping duplicate vertices from a mesh, as well as optimize the mesh for efficient memory access. I'm going to demonstrate Mesh Optimizer by integrating it into my basic mesh class, which is loaded by SIMP, but you can use any method that you want to load your meshes, and it will work in the same way. So the first step is to install Mesh Optimizer. On the GitHub page, you can find binaries for several Linux distributions, as well as a vcpkg file for Windows. I actually didn't try any of these and opted for building from scratch. This is very simple. You need to git clone the repo, open a terminal in the root directory of the project, execute cmake space dot, and open the mesh optimizer solution file with Visual Studio. Choose debug or release build and build the project. You will need to point your sources to the header file meshoptimizer.h under the src directory and link against meshoptimizer.lib, which you will find in the debug or release directory depending on the build type. To make it plug and play with my sources, I added meshoptimizer as a git submodule under the OGLDEV/third-party directory. This means that you need to run git pull or git clone --recurse submodules to make it part of the source tree. I've also added meshoptimizer.lib to OGLDEV/windows/lib, so you don't need to build it on your own. This is a static library, so no DLL is required. Okay, the next step is to integrate it into the basic mesh class. We will load the mesh from file using SIMP and then optimize the memory buffers that it occupies. But we need to do some thinking first. The thing is that I'm using a concept called structure of arrays, or SOA, to organize my vertex buffers. This means that every vertex attribute, such as position, texture coordinates, normals, and etc., is stored in its own vertex buffer. The vertex layout in OpenGL is configured in a way so that the vertex shader will pull each attribute from the corresponding location in the vertex buffer. This doesn't play well with Mesh Optimizer because the library assumes that all the vertex attributes are packed together in the same structure. This means an array of structures, or AOS. So the first step is to transform the basic mesh class from SOA to AOS. Now you may already be using AOS, so you can skip this step, but several people have told me that they found SOA to be unintuitive, so I'd like to demonstrate how to do this change. Okay, so this is the basic mesh class here, and we have the SOA version on the left-hand side and the AOS version on the right-hand side. And as you can see, most of it is the same. We just have a few changes. So let's scroll down. And here in the SOA version, we used to have three different vectors, STD vectors for the positions, the normals, and the textural coordinates. And in the AOS version, we have a single vector called vertices of the vertex structure, which is defined here, and this contains all these elements. In addition to that, we have a few OpenGL buffers. Okay, so previously we had one for the index and then three for the different attributes. And now we still have one for the index buffer, of course, but we just need one vertex buffer for everything here together. So now let's see the changes in the implementation. So we start by reserving space in these vectors. And this is very straightforward. We used to reserve the same number of vertices in each of the vectors. And now we have just one vector, okay? Next, we go to the init single mesh function. So previously, we would push each attribute into the corresponding vector. Okay, but now we prepare a single vertex variable and we set the position, the normal, and the textural coordinates, and then push it into the vertices vector. The final step is to organize the vertex layout for the vertex shader. As I said, we used to have a dedicated vertex buffer for each type of attribute. So we would bind the buffer to the GL array buffer target and then upload the corresponding vector using GL buffer data. Okay, position, textural coordinates, and normals. But now in the AOS version, we have a single vertex buffer. So we bind it here and then all the vertices are uploaded together in the same manner by calling GL buffer data. Okay, the vertices vector. Next, we need to enable the vertex attribute for the vertex shader, but there is no change here because we have the same attributes going to the same indices in the vertex shader. So in both cases, we call enable vertex attrib array for the corresponding attribute index. After enabling the vertex attribute, we need to call GL vertex attrib pointer to set the layout for this attribute. Okay, so you can see that we have the same index and the size of the attribute hasn't changed. Okay, so we have 3 floating points for the position, 2 for the textural coordinates, and finally 3 for the normals. Okay, so this is the same in both SOA and AOS. The only change is in the last 2 parameters to this function. First of all, we have the stride between 2 consecutive attributes. And because in the SOA version, the attributes are packed together, we can put 0 for the stride for each attribute. In the AOS version, we have the 3 attributes for 1 vertex, and then again for the next one. So the stride for each of the attributes is the size of the vertex structure. And finally, we have the offset to the specific attribute. But again, because in the SOA version, these are packed together, the attributes, we can put 0 here. In the AOS version, we start at 0 with the position, and then we need to jump forward to the textural coordinates and the normals. So what I've done is to create a variable called numFloats, which tracks the number of floating points. And you can see that after setting the position, we increment it by 3 and then by 2 for the textural coordinates. And for the normal, we don't care because this is the last one. So what we need to do to calculate the offset is to multiply the number of floating points by the size of a single floating point and then cast it to const void pointer. And that's basically it. We now have an AOS version of the basic mesh class. Okay, we can now start the actual integration. First of all, let's include meshoptimizer.h at the top of the CPP file. The way that SIMP is structured is that the loaded model file may include several mesh structures that correspond to how the asset was modeled. For example, Blender includes a scene hierarchy, and the elements here are usually translated to these mesh structures. Each SIMP structure includes its own vectors of vertices and indices, and the indices are zero-based. I prefer loading everything into a single vertex buffer, so we maintain a base vertex and base index attributes for each SIMP mesh that allows us to render each individual mesh independently and switch materials between meshes. Now, it's very important to optimize each SIMP mesh separately. Otherwise, the indices might cross meshes and the model will not render correctly. I'm saying this because I actually hit this problem on my initial implementation, so make sure not to make the same mistake. In the init all meshes function, we call the original init single mesh function or the new init single mesh opt depending on the macro use mesh optimizer. This macro is defined at the top of the header file of this class. We can see that the new function defines a couple of local vectors for the vertices and indices. These local vectors are used instead of the class attributes, which are used in the non-optimized case. The reason is that the local vectors will be optimized, and the result will be copied into the class attributes. After the local vectors have been populated, we call optimizeMesh, where the real action takes place. This function takes the mesh index and the two local vectors as parameters. The first step is to get rid of all the duplicate vertices which are often present in model files. Now, if you're familiar with SIMP, then you probably know that there is an SIMP load flag called join identical vertices, which practically does the same thing. So in this case, the problem of duplicate vertices is already solved, but remember that not everyone is using SIMP, and if you're writing your own loader, then this feature is extremely valuable. As a preliminary step, Mesh Optimizer wants us to create something which it calls a remap table. This table contains information about vertex duplicates and will be used in the next two function calls. The remap table itself is simply an array of unsigned integers, and it is initialized with the current unoptimized number of indices. Notice that I'm making an extensive use of the standard template library of C++, and that the data function provides direct access to the underlying array of the vector object. The function generateVertexRemap takes the address and size of the unoptimized index and vertex arrays, as well as the size of the vertex structure. The last parameter tells the mesh optimizer how to identify individual vertices in the buffer. The first parameter is the destination address for the remap table. This function returns the number of unique vertices. We are now ready to create an optimized index and vertex arrays without any duplicates. We prepare two vectors for that. The optimized index array is initialized with the original number of indices. We will later see a method for reducing the number of indices, but for now the original size will suffice. The optimized vertex array is of course initialized with the optimized number of vertices. The two functions we will use are called remapIndexBuffer and remapVertexBuffer. The first parameter in both functions is the destination address. The second and third parameters are the source address and the number of source elements, respectively. The last parameter is the remap table. Notice that remapVertexBuffer also takes the size of the vertex structure. We now have an optimized index and vertex arrays. By the way, Mesh Optimizer is also capable of producing an index buffer from scratch for a vertex buffer which simply contains a list of triangles. In this case, replace the address of the unoptimized index array with null when calling generateVertexRemap and remapIndexBuffer. Also, the number of indices needs to be initialized to the number of triangles times 3. The second optimization improves the performance of the vertex shader cache on the GPU. In general, the GPU needs to execute a vertex shader on every vertex. When an index buffer is used, there is a chance that the GPU will index into a vertex which was recently used. The GPU caches the vertex shader results and can skip the execution of the vertex shader when the current vertex is found in the cache. The size of the cache and its replacement policy may differ between GPU brands, but in general we can assume some form of a least recently used algorithm. Mesh Optimizer provides the function optimizeVertexCache, which reorders the triangles in the index buffer to maximize the locality of reused indices and takes advantage of the vertex shader cache. You can create a new optimized index array or perform an in-place reordering on the same array. I'm doing the latter here, so the destination and source address is the same. In addition, we need to provide the number of indices and the optimized number of vertices. The next optimization is really interesting. The triangles eventually reach the rasterizer, and the fragment shader is executed on each of their pixels. Before this execution takes place, the depth test is performed, which allows us to skip the fragment shader in the case of a more distant pixel. Therefore, it would be better to process the closest pixels first, which will allow us to skip more fragments. This optimization obviously depends on the view vector, which is dynamic, but Mesh Optimizer is capable of reordering the triangles to reduce the overdraw from all directions. It's recommended to perform this optimization after the vertex cache optimization. The function here is called optimizeOverdraw. The first two parameters are again the destination and source address of the index array, and we can use the same value here, same as before. Next, we have the number of indices. The next parameter is the location of the position vector inside the vertex structure. Mesh Optimizer assumes the position is a 3D floating point vector and requires it to be within the first 12 bytes of the vertex. After that comes the number of optimized vertices and the size of the vertex structure. This algorithm might hurt the performance of the vertex cache, so we need to balance the two optimizations. The last parameter indicates how much we can compromise the hit ratio of the vertex cache. As a rule of thumb, it's recommended that the hit ratio will go down by no more than 5%. At this point, we have another optimization for accessing the vertex buffer. Before the vertex shader is executed, the vertex must be fetched from the vertex buffer. It's important to keep the vertices close to each other, depending on their execution order. This will improve the locality of memory access. The function optimizeVertexFetch reorders the vertices in the vertex array and rewrites the indices to match. The first two parameters are the destination addresses for the vertex and index arrays. Then we have the number of indices and the source address of the vertex array. Next we have the optimized number of vertices and finally the size of the vertex structure. Okay, I hope you guys are still with me, because the last optimization is probably the most interesting one. You are probably familiar with MIP mapping in the context of textures, where a higher resolution texture is used close to the camera, and vice versa. We can do the same thing with models, because the viewer is probably not going to notice a decrease in visual detail as the object becomes more distant. In fact, it's still a common practice to create the same model in several levels of details and select the proper one based on the distance from the camera. The following optimization creates a less detailed model according to the requested threshold. We begin by defining the threshold as a fraction between 0 and 1. This value indicates the number of indices in the final result, so we multiply it by the original number of indices to get the target number of indices. This of course is a hint, so the final result may deviate from the target. Next we define the target error percentage, again between 0 and 1. The higher the value of the target error, the less chance there is that the algorithm will be able to deliver, so we will need to tune this based on visual appearance. Next we initialize an index array for the simplified model using the original number of indices. The function that performs the algorithm is called simplify. The first parameter is the destination address of the simplified index array. Next we have the source address of the index array and the number of indices. Next we provide the address of the first position vector in the vertex array, same as before, and the number of optimized vertices. After that comes the size of the vertex structure, the target number of indices, and finally, the target error. This function returns the reduced index count, so we can now resize the index buffer to match it. We can use the optimized index buffer with the same vertex buffer, or generate a smaller vertex buffer using optimized vertex fetch. Remember that all the optimizations were performed on the local vertex and index arrays, so we need to concatenate them to the corresponding arrays, which are maintained as class attributes. These arrays will eventually make it into the OpenGL buffers. Finally, we update the number of indices in the array of meshes in the class. This value will be used to render the current mesh. And that is it for today. There are still mesh optimizer algorithms for you to explore, such as vertex quantization, buffer compression, triangle strip conversions, and more. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.